Good morning, students. Today we are going to start with a new chapter, psoriasis. It is a dermatological disease. I'll share the PPT. Is this visible for you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
First, let's see what is psoriasis. Psoriasis, it is a chronic inflammatory disorder of the skin and joints, which is characterized by recurrent exacerbations and remissions of thickened erythematous and scaling plaques. It is a chronic inflammatory skin and joint disorder, which is characterized by recurrent exacerbations and remissions of thickened erythematous and scaling plaques. Coming to the etiology of psoriasis, the etiology of psoriasis is a combination of genetic and environmental factors. In most cases, there is a genetic predisposition, and almost 70% of the patients report a familial history of psoriasis. So first, let's see what are the environmental factors: climate, stress, alcohol, smoking, infection, trauma, and drugs can aggravate the psoriasis. And warm seasons and sunlight, about 80% of the patient's condition get worsens during warm season and in sunlight. And 90% report worsening in cold weather. And next is the genetic factors. Multiple genes are likely to influence the disease's susceptibility and the severity and clinical subtypes. The gene like HLA, CW6 is having 15-fold chances to develop psoriasis. So it is having a stronger association with HLA, CW6 than CW6. There will be more chances to develop psoriasis. Next is the precipitating factors or the risk factors of psoriasis. The first one is infections, bacterial infections and HIV infection. Bacterial infections have been implicated as trigger factors for psoriasis. So bacterial infections like streptococcal infections, particularly pharyngitis, precedes the onset of guttate psoriasis. Guttate psoriasis, it is a type of psoriasis. We'll see what are the types of psoriasis later after this. Coming to HIV infection can aggravate psoriasis. That is, the severity of psoriasis will be greater in patients with HIV infection. Next is drugs. These drugs can exacerbate or induce psoriasis in predisposed individuals. And some most common causative agents are lithium, beta blockers, anti-malarials, NSAIDs, tetracyclines, and rapid withdrawal of systemic corticosteroids. These can aggravate psoriasis. And next is alcohol and smoking. Alcohol may exacerbate, or excess alcohol consumption may exacerbate the established psoriasis. And also, smoking is strongly associated with plamoplantar psoriasis. It is other type of psoriasis in which smoking, it is most commonly seen in smokers. Next is emotional stress. So stress is an important trigger factor in psoriasis. It is having clinical evidences demonstrated that severity of psoriasis can correlate with prior stress in patients. Next is Koeppner phenomenon. So this is referred to psoriatic lesions which occur at sites of injury to the skin, such as cut, burn, scratch, or surgical scar. So development of psoriasis in any lesions which occurs at the injury sites. These are the precipitating factors of psoriasis: infections, drugs, alcohol and smoking, emotional stress, and Koeppner phenomenon. Next is the pathophysiology of psoriasis. So psoriasis is cell-mediated immune mechanism. In psoriasis, cell-mediated immune mechanism plays a central role. So important role is having for cell-mediated immune mechanism. Here, the cutaneous inflammatory T cell mediated immune activation requires two T cell signals via cell-cell interactions by surface proteins and APC. APC stands for antigen presenting cells. APCs like dendritic cells or macrophages. So cutaneous inflammatory T cell mediated immune activation requires two T cell signals via cell-cell interactions by surface proteins and antigen presenting cells like dendritic cells or macrophages. As I told, it needed two signals, T cell signals. So first signal is the interaction of T cell receptor with antigen presented by antigen presenting cell. And the second signal, which is also known as co-stimulation, is mediated through various surface interactions. So once the T cells are activated, they migrate from lymph nodes and the bloodstream into skin and secrete various cytokines. So these cytokines are primarily interferon gamma and interleukin 2. And these cytokines induces the pathologic changes of psoriasis. And also local keratinocytes and neutrophils are induced to produce other cytokines. And as a result of pathogenic T cell production and activation, the psoriatic epidermal cells will proliferate 7 times faster than the normal epidermal cells. So as a result of pathogenic T cell activation and production, the psoriatic epidermal cells will proliferate 7 times faster than the normal epidermal cells. So this is the pathologic changes which happens during psoriasis. Next is the clinical presentation. The psoriatic lesions are relatively asymptomatic, but about 20% of patients complains of pruritus. Generally, it is accumulated, immature, excessively thickened skin that is manifested as plaques. And the symptoms for severe widespread psoriasis may include exfoliative dermatitis, fever, and chills. And other condition is psoriatic arthritis. It is a distinct clinical entity in which both the psoriatic lesions and inflammatory arthritis-like symptoms occur here. In this condition, distal interphalangeal joints and adjacent nails are commonly involved in psoriatic arthritis. And also knees, elbows, wrist, and ankles involved in this. So distal interphalangeal joints and adjacent nails are commonly involved, and also knees, elbows, wrist, and ankles. And the lesions are characterized by sharply demarcated erythematous papules and plaque covered with silver white fine scales. And if these fine scales are removed, a salmon pink lesion is exposed there. Next is the diagnosis part. In psoriasis, it is mainly based on physical examination findings of the characteristics of lesions. And also a medical history should be taken from the patient, and it should include some points like onset and duration of the lesion. Then any familial history of psoriasis, then presence of exacerbating factors and previous history of anti-psoriatic treatment. And if the patient may have any exposure to chemicals, toxins, or allergens, these all information should be taken from the patient, that is the medical history. And laboratory test, skin biopsy of lesion skins, it is very useful in confirming the diagnosis. Next is the clinical types of psoriasis. I told you there are different types of psoriasis. Let's see what are the clinical types of psoriasis. First one is psoriasis vulgaris, guttate psoriasis, scalp psoriasis, psoriatic nail disease, palmoplantar psoriasis, flexure psoriasis, psoriatic arthropathy, erythrodermic psoriasis. These are the different types of psoriasis. Now, let's see one by one what are these characteristics of these psoriasis, these types of psoriasis. First one is psoriasis vulgaris. Psoriasis vulgaris, it is also known as chronic plaque psoriasis. This psoriasis vulgaris is also known as chronic plaque psoriasis. It can occur at any age, but most often it begins in young adulthood and has a chronic relapsing course. The typical psoriatic lesion is a red, sharply demarcated plaque with overlying silvery scale. And the distribution is usually symmetrical. It also involves elbows and knees commonly. Then other sites are the sacrum, scalp and nails. The plaques may itch, but not usually to the severity of eczematous plaques. This is about psoriasis vulgaris. And next is guttate psoriasis. Guttate psoriasis most commonly seen in children and young adults. It is characterized by a widespread scaly eruption of small teardrop-like scaly plaques. The presentation is often acute and can appear 10 to 14 days after a streptococcal upper respiratory tract infection. And in this type of psoriasis, topical treatments or UVB phototherapy are usually effective. UVB phototherapy is type B ultraviolet light. That type of phototherapy. We'll see in detail about phototherapy in the treatment part. Next is scalp psoriasis. So involvement of scalp is the only manifestation of psoriasis in some patients. But it may also occur in psoriasis vulgaris. And it appears as scaly, demarcated plaques extending to the hairline and around the ears. In this type, hair loss is rare. Next type is psoriatic nail disease. The nails are frequently affected in psoriasis, in this type of psoriasis. In a small portion of patients, the nails are the only area affected. And here, the changes include nail pitting, nail ridging, onycholysis. Onycholysis is, we have seen earlier in other chapter, that is the removal of the nail from the nail bed. Then hyperkeratosis under the nail and complete nail destruction. Topical treatments are rarely effective for psoriatic nail disease. And here systemic treatments such as methotrexate, when prescribed for other generalized psoriasis, it may also improve the nail disease. Next is palmoplantar psoriasis. The sites are palms and soles. Sharp demarcation of the involved areas will be seen. Palmoplantar psoriasis can take two forms. First one is inflamed hyperkeratotic fissured skin. It can be very painful. And the second one is sterile pustules on any erythematous base. That is also known as palmoplantar pustulosis. This will be dry to leave small brown macules. And this pustular form is much more common in smokers. Next one is flexular psoriasis. This type of psoriasis can occur at flexural sites such as the axillae, groin, submammary areas and genitalia. The lesions differ from differ in appearance from classical psoriasis, and it tend to be red and glazed rather than scaly. And this is because of the friction and moisture within the skin foldings. So that's why the lesions here appears red and glazed. And in this type, the chances of secondary infection will be more, which is particularly with candida. Next one is psoriatic arthropathy. So 25% of patients with psoriasis suffer with an associated arthropathy. And in this type of patients, rheumatoid factor will be negative. And there are five patterns of psoriatic arthropathy: monoarthropathy, rheumatoid arthritis-like, osteoarthritis-like, sacroiliitis like and arthritis mutilans. These are the five types of psoriatic arthropathy. And some treatments effective for skin psoriasis are also effective in psoriatic arthropathy, including methotrexate and biological agents with action against TNF-alpha. Next, the last one is erythrodermic psoriasis. It is also known as erythroderma or exfoliative dermatitis. Erythrodermic psoriasis is also known as erythroderma or exfoliative dermatitis. It is potentially a life-threatening condition in which more than 90% of the body surface is red and scaly. And this can occur as a consequence of either eczema or psoriasis. These patients need urgent hospital admission and other supportive therapy and topical treatment can be given. Skin function is impaired and patients suffer dehydration, electrolyte imbalance, temperature dysregulation and secondary infection in this type of psoriasis. So that's with the types of psoriasis. Syed, can you hear me? Just tell me
yes.
Types of psoriasis, what two or three types of psoriasis which we have seen now. Just name
it. We call psoriasis, we have a vulgaris, gutite
scar, yes.
Nail disease, flexural.
Okay. Next, two more by Presley. Say it all, psoriasis vulgaris, gutite psoriasis and psoriatic nail disease. Two more from you, Presley.
Ma'am, you have erythrodermic psoriasis.
Erythrodermic psoriasis, then?
Then you have
scalp, yes, scalp psoriasis. So I'll tell you once more all types of psoriasis. Thank you. Once more, I'll tell you the types of psoriasis. Psoriasis vulgaris, gutite psoriasis, scalp psoriasis, psoriatic nail disease, palmoplantar psoriasis, flexural psoriasis, erythrodermic psoriasis, and psoriatic arthropathy. These are the types of psoriasis which we have seen. Okay. Next, let's see the treatment of psoriasis. First, in treatment, many patients with psoriasis have mild disease and require only emollient therapy. And this is for preventing the drying and fissuring of the elbows and knees. So many of the patients with that, they will be getting cured. And other treatment options should consider based on the types of psoriasis. And sometimes you have to consider patient's occupation and lifestyle factors as well as the severity of the disease. So all should be considered before the treatment starts. In topical therapy, the first line treatment of mild to moderate psoriasis should include an emollient as well as a topical treatment. In topical therapy, the first one is vitamin D analogs. So vitamin D analogs inhibit keratinocyte differentiation and production. It is commonly prescribed vitamin D analog is calcipotriol. The commonly prescribed vitamin D analog is calcipotriol. This is commonly available as lotion, ointment, cream or for scalp treatment. And the efficacy may be enhanced when used in combination with a topical steroid. So when the calcipotriol is combined with the topical steroid, the efficacy will be increased. And patients should be advised to avoid use of delicate skin side because it can cause irritation to the face and flexures. And also hyperkalemia due to systemic absorption can occur if the maximum weekly dose exceeds 100 gram. Next one is steroids. Topical steroids are cosmetically acceptable and easy to apply. The reduction of inflammation is important, and steroids will reduce the inflammation. So as it will allow other treatments to be introduced that would otherwise irritate the inflamed plaques. So when we start the steroids, it will reduce inflammation and it will help to start other treatments. Otherwise, while applying that other topical agents, it will again again irritate that inflamed plates. Next is coal tar. Coal tar has anti-inflammatory, antibacterial, antipruritic, and antimitotic effect. A variety of preparations are available in this coal tar, like bath preparation, shampoos, creams, and ointments. Coal tar concentrations of 1-10% can be used. Coal tar in combination with topical steroids can be effective. For example, Alfosil HC. And the efficacy of tar is enhanced when used with UVB light therapy, that is known as Goyer-Kerman regimen. The efficacy of the tar enhances when used with UVB light therapy. And UVB type B ultraviolet light, wavelength of 290 nanometer to 320 nanometer. Next is dithranol. And before that, I want to tell the limitations of coal tar. The main limitation of coal tar are they'll be having irritations of delicate skin sites, some odor, and also it can cause temporary staining of skin and clothing. That are the limitations of coal tar. Next one is dithranol. It is an anti-proliferative and anti-inflammatory effect on the skin. It has anti-proliferative and anti-inflammatory effect on the skin, and it is one of the oldest treatment used to stable chronic plaque psoriasis. The starting concentration of dithranol is usually 0.5%, which can be increased slowly if tolerated up to 3%. So although this is effective, some practical drawbacks are there for this treatment, that includes burning and irritation of the normal skin and staining of the clothes, as well as strong odor. So these are the drawbacks of the dithranol. Next is salicylic acid. This is useful to reduce scale, particularly while treating hyperkeratosis of the palms and soles, and it can be mixed with coal tar, steroid, or urea. Next is phototherapy. So phototherapy has an immune suppressive effect on skin, and it has been used in the treatment of psoriasis for over 80 years. Phototherapy, narrow band UVB, that is wavelength of 311 to 330 nanometer, which is preferable to broad band UVB. Narrow band wavelength is 311 to 330 nanometer, and broad band UVB 290 to 320 nanometer. This one is preferable due to increased safety and reduced risk of burning. Next is PUVA, PUVA, that is sorolens plus UVA light. Sorolens plus UVA light. It has a valuable role in the treatment of stable, moderate to severe psoriasis. The sorolens interfere with DNA synthesis and reduces the epidermal turnover. Sorolens are drugs that are activated by long wave ultraviolet light, that wavelength is 320 to 400 nanometer, and these are taken orally 2 hours before exposure to UVA light. And the treatment is usually given twice a week for a 6-week period. The eyes are always protected due to the risk of cataracts during the treatment, and patients are also given sunglasses to wear for 12 hours after the treatment. The common adverse effect is nausea due to ingestion of oral sorolens, and the most serious adverse effect is an increased risk of long-term cutaneous malignancy. That is with PUVA, sorolens plus UVA light. Next one is systemic therapy. The systemic therapy is given to patients with intolerance and severe widespread of psoriasis, or with rapidly relapsing, even after topical therapy and phototherapy. To such patients, we'll prescribe systemic therapy. And this commonly prescribed systemic therapies are with methotrexate, acitretin, and cyclosporin. First one, let's see the methotrexate. Methotrexate is given as a once weekly oral low dose regimen with an initial test dose of 5 mg increasing up to 30 mg weekly. And methotrexate is, before that I want to add a point, methotrexate, it is a folic acid antagonist which is used in moderate to severe psoriasis. And it is a first line therapy in systemic agents. And acute toxicity occurs due to the effect of methotrexate on folic acid metabolism. So in this can cause this toxicity can be seen as myelosuppression and gastrointestinal bleeding because of rapidly dividing cells in bone marrow and gastrointestinal tract. And in such cases, folinic acid rescue can be used to oppose the folate antagonist effect at a dose of 120 mg folinic acid over 12 to 24 hours intravenously or intramuscularly in divided doses followed by 15 mg per kg orally every 6 hours to 48 hours. This is to reduce the adverse effects. And hepatic fibrosis is the commonest long-term risk for methotrexate. And and some patients complained of nausea and other gastrointestinal side effects as well as lethargy. And for reducing the adverse effects, the patients can be given folic acid 5 mg on the days methotrexate is not prescribed. Next one is acitretin. Acitretin, it is a vitamin A derivative which inhibits epidermal proliferation and is effective for disorders of keratinization, including chronic plaque psoriasis. The starting dose is usually 25 to 30 mg daily for 2 to 4 weeks, which can be increased to 75 mg daily for short period, according to the clinical response of the patient. There are some mucocutaneous side effects like hair loss and lethargy, which are common to acitretin. And patients should be warned that a rebound response is occasionally seen when stopping treatment. And therefore, a long-term maintenance dose is usually advised. And one more main point is acitretin should be avoided in women of childbearing because there is a teratogenic risk for this drug. Next one is cyclosporin. So cyclosporin, it is an effective treatment for all variants of psoriasis. Cyclosporin treatment for more than 1 year is not advised because of its renal nephrotoxicity. And the dose is 2 to 5 mg per kg. The adverse events of cyclosporin include hypertension, hypertrichosis. Hypertrichosis is increased hair growth over and above the age, sex and race of any individual. And like hirsutism in women. And paresthesia. Paresthesia is tingling and or pricking sensation. Then tremor and increased risk of infections. These are the common adverse effects. Next one is hydroxyurea or hydroxycarbamide. Similar effects on bone marrow and germ cells to methotrexate, but without the hepatotoxic effects. It is having similar effects to methotrexate, but hepatotoxic effects is not there. Then it relapse occurs if on the stopping of the drug. Next is the biological therapy. And biological therapy is recommended for the patients with severe plaque psoriasis defined as PAS1 greater than or equal to 10 and DLQI greater than 10. PAS1, it stands for Psoriasis Area and Severity Index. These are two standards. PASI is Psoriasis Area and Severity Index and DLQI is Dermatology Quality of Life Index. DLQI is Dermatology Quality of Life Index. So when it is more than or equal to 10 to these standards, we will recommend biological therapy and the patient and also to the patients who failed at least two standard systemic agents like methotrexate, cyclosporin or acitretin or one systemic agent and phototherapy. If the patient failed to that, then only we will prescribe for the biological therapy. The TNF-alpha antagonist, the tumor necrosis factor antagonist, infliximab, then adalimumab and etanercept all have immunosuppressant action. TNF-alpha is a pro-inflammatory cytokine that plays a central role in pathogenesis of psoriasis. So proven efficacy in severe psoriasis for TNF-alpha antagonist. And this is the treatment algorithm for psoriasis. It is based on the increasing PASI and DLQI. That's why you can see the increased size of the blocks. As the PASI and DLQI increases, we'll shift to the alternative treatments. So first one starts with emollients, topical vitamin D3 analogs, steroids and tar. If it is poor response means or the condition is not getting reduced, broadband UVB, narrowband UVB, PUVA with or without short contact dithranol or tar. Then again, poor response means you can start with methotrexate, cyclosporine, acitretin or hydroxylurea. And if patient is not showing good response for this, biological therapy is recommended for the patients, those with severe plague or patients fail to at least two standard systemic agents. And along with this treatment, it is important to give psychological support and understanding of individual patient's needs. And also lifestyle should be improved, which can increase adherence to the treatment. So that's with the psoriasis treatment. These are the points which you have to study according to your syllabus. And today we have seen the definition of psoriasis, types of psoriasis, the clinical presentation and diagnosis, pathophysiology and treatment of the psoriasis. I think this topic is clear for you, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes,
ma'am. And I'll send you the notes, and also you have to refer the textbook for further reference, okay?
Sure, ma'am.
And okay. One second.